Well, thank you very much indeed for that welcome. Thank you all for coming. There's one thing I want to begin by saying. You are all beautiful, and I love you all. And I won't love you any more if you lose any weight, and I won't love you any less if you gain some. So throughout the evening, I know from personal experience talking about weight, that at some point we will all be forced to look at our midriffs and wonder who we are and how we became who we are. And nothing about tonight should make anyone feel worse about themselves. But I do hope it will leave everyone a bit empowered to make some decisions about their health and their life. And that might help you love yourselves a little bit more, those changes that you can make. So hopefully we'll get there because we have fantastic people. I think obesity, for me, the obesity crisis, represents a social and political problem as much as a scientific problem. And we have a real manifestation of the inequality and the difficulty of many people's lives in Britain today. And that point was made to me very clearly when I was on the Brexit bus, I mean the Remain bus, but we called it the Brexit bus, with David Cameron. And he said, I wasn't expecting this question at all, he said, what should we do about childhood obesity in the UK? And I said, well, I think the social determinants of health are pretty wide, and I think you need to think about opportunity and economics and education and sport in schools and all sorts of other things. And he said, oh my God, man, you can't expect me to fix everything. That was really what he said. And I said, well, I do expect you to. Well, no, I said, oh, of course, Prime Minister, you're not. Anyway, Jamie Oliver was also giving him a hug. I see. So I think there has never been a worse time to try and answer the question, what should I do about childhood obesity if I'm the Prime Minister, or what should I do about my own waistline in many ways, because it is so profoundly confusing. I tried to write, or I did write, a diet book last year, and I find trying, with a medical degree and a degree in public health, and having made quite a bit of TV about it, and knowing a lot of people, I still found it hard to gather up the evidence and make sense of it all. So I feel very, very lucky that we have such a wonderful group of experts, many of whom I've met and know from before, gathered here this evening. So the event is called The Bittersweet Truth About What We Eat, Nutrition, Health, and the Science of the Gut. And I think what will be lovely is we're going to dig into how the molecules that we put in our mouths affect the chemistry in our bodies and the bacteria that live in and on us, and how that science might interact with the way we choose to live our lives. So I'm going to introduce our speakers. Dr. Sarah Jarvis is an NHS GP, and quite why she is not at home in front of the telly with a box of wine and a curry, I have no idea. You deserve a medal for being anywhere other than crying in your bath. She's also, I sincerely mean that this is the hardest job in England. She's the clinical director of patient.info. She's the resident doctor on the Jeremy Vine show and on the One show. She's the author of 6 books on health and medicine, including 3 books in the popular Four Dummies series, including Diabetes for Dummies. And Sarah, can I just ask you, how did you become interested in food and nutrition?
I've always been interested in food and human nutrition. When I was at school, I was the little swotty girl who was 2 years younger than everybody else in my class, so I was always much shorter, and I was fairly broad, all things being relative. So I decided I needed to do something about it. Went to Cambridge and decided that I had the opportunity to spend a year doing something else, and did food and human nutrition. And my undergraduate thesis was on the dietary fiber and the etiology of disease. And the rest is history, really.
I love that. So I decided to do something about my weight by going to Cambridge and writing a thesis. Right.
Pretty much.
Great, good answer. Professor Tim Spector. Tim is a professor of epidemiology at King's College London. He is a world expert, I say the world expert, but he's more modest than me, in genetic studies of twins. He is the author of The Diet Myth, The Real Science Behind What We Eat, which many people have described as life-changing. He leads the UK's largest open-source science project, British Gut, to understand the microbial diversity of the human gut. Tim, can you talk a bit about how you became interested in food and nutrition?
Well, I've been studying genes in the twins for years, as you know, and studied your genes. And been discovering these things, but didn't really get interested in nutrition until about 6 years ago, at the top of an Italian mountain, when I actually got sick and ended up, with double vision and having various health problems and high blood pressure. And then very selfishly said, I want to find out what the best diet is for me. And at the same time, I was started to write a book about it. And basically, that's the point. I realized how little we knew about the whole subject, how most of it was BS, and we'd been, you know, misled. And I wanted to really get into it and start to, you know, help other people go on the same sort of journey as I did.
I love that. So that trumps even Sarah's answer. Sarah went to Cambridge, you decided to enroll a huge cohort of twins and write a book. Okay, yeah. Great. Professor Eran Segal, is a computational biologist at the Weizmann Institute in Israel. He runs the Personalized Nutrition Project, which uses an algorithm to create personalized diets in order to lower blood glucose responses to food. Eran, can you talk a bit about how you became interested in this? Because your background is not the same, or similar to the rest of us.
Right. Yeah, so for one thing, my wife is a clinical dietitian, so these discussions have always been at home. But about 5 years ago, also like Tim, from a personal interest, I'm an amateur long-distance runner, and I just became interested in what's the best diet for me. I started reading a lot of literature and books and so on, and I really found, I was shocked at how much little science there is behind everything that is publicized to us about what we should eat. And so being a scientist, I thought this is actually an opportunity to find out and research what is really healthy food for us. And after 5 years, I can say that I think we came up on very surprising findings, which I'm happy to share with you tonight.
Amazing. So we're looking forward to that. And it is interesting how much personal interest the scientists working in this area have. And I count myself in that group, at least with a personal interest. Now, is Gary available? Oh, he's hit a bit. Gary, how are you?
I am good. How are you?
I'm very well. Gary, I'm going to introduce you and then sorry, you hadn't appeared until just now. Very nice to see you. So Gary Taubes is an award-winning American science and health writer, the author of the acclaimed new book, The Case Against Sugar. He's the co-founder of the Nutrition Science Initiative, and his previous publications include Why We Get Fat and The Diet Delusion. Gary, can you tell us a bit about how you got interested in food and nutrition?
I can, and thank you. I'm obviously, one of the things I find fascinating is we all got into this because we didn't like the quality of the science that was out there to begin with, which is the science we all grew up on. I was an investigative journalist, and investigative science journalist. My specialty was controversial science. And in the late 90s, I literally stumbled into this controversy over whether salt causes high blood pressure. And pretty quickly came to the revelation that all the everything I had learned in my previous career that you had to do to get science right, to establish reliable knowledge, all the meticulous, rigorous, skeptical methodology that's required to get the right answer was considered kind of a luxury in public health and nutrition science, because it was just too hard to do, too expensive to do. And so we had embraced a lot of mistaken assumptions, or likely to be mistaken assumptions. And I spent the next 10 years of my life doing nothing but research to figure out what might be reliable knowledge and what continues to be assumptions.
So what I want to do now, thank you, Gary, what I want to do now is go through, we want to get to the Q&A as quickly as possible, because I think your questions should really drive the evening. But I'm going to go in a bit more detail with each speaker and get the panelists talking to each other. Gary, I'm going to start with you. Your work, in a way, to me, is absolutely extraordinary. As a bit of journalism, as a bit of digging, you have been unbelievably thorough, wrestling with a body of scientific work that is extremely difficult to understand and where there are very intense vested interests. And I would say your articles in the New York Times, I remember reading your first big article in the New York Times, and that definitely changed my life and it changed the way I eat. And yet, I think at the heart of it, I do have some skepticism about whether or not you're right about sugar and insulin and calories. So can you talk us through the argument you're making in The Case Against Sugar, your new book?
I can, although I have to say that after, and I have to apologize, it's a little bit of echo on my line here from 6,000 miles away, so it's a little hard to concentrate. I wanted to stop about three quarters of the way through your introduction and think it's not going to get any better than this. We should just stop now. the gist of it is, since the 1950s and 1960s, driven by some very questionable science, driven by some very questionable American science, we embrace some assumptions about what constitutes a healthy diet, what the cause of obesity is. The primary assumptions were obesity is what we call an energy balance disorder, and in that sense, pretty much the only way that foods affect our body weight is through the caloric content, or the digestible caloric content of these foods, and anything else these foods might do regarding hormonal physiological responses is irrelevant when it comes to whether or not we get fat. And then we focus on dietary fat as the cause of heart disease, and we spent the next 20 years from the 1977 through the early part of this century trying to put everyone in the world effectively on low-fat, low-saturated fat diets. And as I did this research, I went back into even the 19th century and followed research on obesity and diabetes forward from that point in time. It became clear that, from my perspective, clearly obesity is a hormonal regulatory disorder. So as we get fatter, we don't get fatter as we get older just because we eat more calories. We get fatter as we get older because those calories have specific effects in our body that drive our fat cells to accumulate excess fat and hold on to it. And the refined grains and specifically the sugars in our diet have unique effects that fats and protein don't have that drive these phenomena. So my first two books targeted both sugar and refined grains. And my third book zeroes in on the specific effect of sugar and an attempt to answer a single, what I think vitally important question, which is we have obesity and diabetes epidemics that erupt worldwide whenever populations transition from a traditional diet, whatever that diet might happen to be, whether it's a Southeast Asian diet or an Inuit diet or a Maasai diet or an agrarian diet in the Himalayas. Add a Western diet and lifestyle, you end up with obesity and diabetes and remarkable numbers, terrifying, unimaginable numbers of diabetes cases specifically. And the prime suspect has always been sugar when these epidemics erupt. And I'm making the case in this book, and I describe it as the prosecution's argument, that it should remain sugar for a lot of different reasons, even though ultimately the experimental evidence is ambiguous.
Perfect. Thank you very much. The central thesis of what Gary's saying is that a calorie from sugar will induce hormonal changes in your body, particularly around insulin, that will cause you to lay down more fat and lead to long-term health problems in different ways to calories from other kinds of food. And so sugar in food is the central driver of the obesity epidemic. Now, what I want to do, Tim has... Tim's work is different, and I'm not sure Tim agrees. So can you pick up on that and say what you make of that, Tim?
Yeah, well, I mean, I agree with a lot of what Gary's said and is in his book about also the way the science has been done and the industry has played a role. So we agree on a lot of things. Where I would take some differences is picking on one food ingredient and saying that's the enemy, we kick that out, because this is where fadism has come from, and if we, that's going to be true for some people, but not for others. So I think, absolutely, you can have too much sugar and fizzy drinks and processed foods. We're all agreeing are wrong, but where you draw the line about whether people should stop eating rice or pasta totally, the Italians and the Japanese do that and still manage to stay pretty well because they have a balanced, diverse diet, and I think. My whole, but the tenet really of my book and my research was that we shouldn't be picky on one thing of good food. I mean, let's cut out processed foods, but of the real foods, we want a mixture of stuff, and we want to have that huge diversity, which is really important for our gut microbes. So that's really where I'm coming from. And if we pick on one process and say insulin is the reason for it, that's naive to think that we know enough about the human body to just pick on that particular process, and for some people it will be bad, but others not.
Can I just pin you down on that, though? Because I think many of you may be aware of the sort of insulin carbohydrate hypothesis that makes you fat. And it's very seductive. We know that insulin is almost exactly the same molecule as growth hormone. We know that patients with diabetes who take more insulin gain weight. Do you think Gary's right that a calorie of sugar will make you fatter than a calorie of fat or protein?
I don't think there is sufficient evidence long-term that that is the case.
And Gary, can I pin you down on that and say, is that what you're saying?
That's the simplest form of what I'm saying, yes, precisely. The argument, and again, I agree with Tim that the evidence doesn't exist long-term. Again, I'm taking this argument from a different philosophical perspective. By the 1960s, it was clear that insulin was the fattening hormone. The lipogenic hormone is how it was described in the 1960s, and we secrete insulin primarily to the carbohydrate content of the diet. And so anything that works to increase insulin chronically over the course of a day will work to increase the fat we mobilize. And then the question is, should this or should this not be the null hypothesis, in the sense that, you know, we created a theory of obesity, a theory of fat accumulation, this energy balance idea that completely leaves out all the hormonal enzymatic regulation of fat accumulation. It's like coming up with a theory about why our children grow that says they grow because they take in more calories than we consume, and we're not going to pay any attention to growth hormone.
Yeah. So, and Gary, can I just, we're going to come back to it. I'm sure lots of people will have questions for you.
Right.
The case for the prosecution, you have many smoking guns, and you have identified a huge number of badly interpreted or badly conducted research, but you don't have the actual thing you need, which is the data that proves that sugar will make you fatter than any other macronutrient. Is that true?
Absolutely. And yet I'm saying that we should assume that it does until we have evidence to refute it, rather than we should assume that it doesn't until we have evidence to, definitive evidence to prove it. Different standards of evidence.
Perfect. We're going to come back to that. I'm going to keep moving. Sarah, what's your take on this? How would you translate this? Sarah's GP practice is in Shepherd's Bush, where I grew up. But you have a catchment area of some really disadvantaged from socioeconomic groups. Mm. Can you talk a bit about how this would work for your patients? What this makes, making sense of that for them?
What really worries me about this is that we've gone from one villain, saturated fat, to another villain, sugar. And the message that that's going to send to my patients is, as long as I avoid sugar, I can do exactly what I want. All the studies that have been done in the past have now been started to be looked at again, and I think there's a very strong feeling that they were perhaps poorly done. But we can't simply take those studies and extrapolate them later and say, right, now we've disproved them. Because, for instance, one of the big arguments was that people who were randomized, in other words, two groups of people, half of them were told, right, you go away and eat a high-fat diet, you go away and eat a low-fat diet, and we'll come back in 10 years and see which of you has had more heart attacks and how many of you have died. As hard outcomes go, death is kind of the hardest you get. And it is very difficult to do studies like this because they do take a very long time. Of course, what happened? 10 years later, they came back and, in fact, there was no difference between the two groups. And that has been taken as the sort of poster boy evidence that actually saturated fat is not bad for you. Well, actually, what we now know is that nobody took any notice of what they ate instead of the high-fat diet. And if I say to my patients, stop eating fat, I know that half of them will promptly go away and substitute it with refined carbohydrates and sugar. So we also know that if you do directly substitute fat for refined carbohydrates, exactly the same thing happens. You don't get any reduction, but you don't get any increase in heart disease. Now, what Gary's saying is, sugar is the bad guy, and therefore, his argument, according to his argument, if you follow it to its logical conclusion, if you stop eating the sugar, actually you should be better off with the saturated fat. You're not. Whereas, if you look at studies which have gone on for 30 years, followed 120,000 people, you see that people who substituted, instead of having either saturated fat or refined carbohydrates, had instead plant proteins or unrefined carbohydrates, or all the things that we see as being, quote, good, you can reduce the risk of heart disease. So I think what I'm saying is, Sugar is bad, absolutely no question. Sugar contributes to obesity, absolutely no question. Saturated fat, I think, is also bad. There is good evidence that saturated fat increases insulin resistance, that it makes it more difficult for your body to deal with insulin or to respond to sugar. And that means it produces more insulin, which does what? Makes you put on more weight, makes you prone to type 2 diabetes. My patients don't eat nutrients, they eat food.
And do you think, I mean, I notice as well that people get fatigued with the entire thing. And when you have the entire public health community saying, as they did when I was young, don't eat saturated fat, eggs are bad for you, butter's bad for you, and then it flips and suddenly everyone's saying eggs are good and you can put butter in your coffee in the morning, you have this weird moment. I think a decent number of your patients will just go, these doctors haven't got a clue.
Oh, and
they're
they
making
do.
It up as they go along. And I'm going to ignore
all
of it.
You got it wrong last time, yeah. Doc. Why should I listen to you now?
Yeah.
Can I clarify kind of scientific arrogance. For a second? Gary, can I clarify a few things here for a second? I'm going to play. I love playing the role of the investigative reporter. First of all, the kind of studies that Sarah is talking about are observational studies. So when I first got into the field of public health, it was to critique the way these observational studies are used. They're not intervention studies. We don't randomize subjects to different diets. We follow individuals and for 30 years to see what they ate and whether or not they get healthy. And those studies can't be interpreted the way Sarah just interpreted them. I'm sorry, Sarah, it's just a fact of life. It's an overinterpretation of the data. And when I keep harping on how
we don't have an alternative and we have such large studies, you can't put the same weight on them, but you absolutely can interpret them when you've got enough of them, especially when you control for enough confounding factors. And that's exactly what these studies do.
Yeah. This is if we go back to the very first article I wrote on epidemiology for the journal Science in 1993, the people said to me, well, this is the best they can do, therefore they can overinterpret the data. And if we brought a group of physicists and sat them down at this table, they would say, if this is the best you could do, do something else, because you're never justified in overinterpreting the data. The other point, Zan, that you just made that I wanted to respond to is it's absolutely true that we were wrong about saturated fat. One of the reasons we know that is because of my work. So I probably did more than anyone alive to demonstrate all the errors in that work. The point is, so it indeed confuses people. Anyone who takes diet advice from a journalist should have their head examined. But we have epidemics out there and they are caused by something. And obesity and diabetes increase the risk of heart disease. So it's like here in the US, you know, if O.J. Simpson famously did not kill his wife, somebody else did. To say that it would confuse a jury to make that case is a little bit sophisticated. What we have to do is figure out.
I think
out
it did in the case
causes
of the O.J. trial.
Now, look, Gary,
I hate to cut you off mid-flow, but we're gonna. I know that we're gonna come back to this with the Q&A. So I want to keep going just so that we get through the panel and get to the Q&A. Will you? Is that? But you did a lot of the heavy lifting there for me. Thank you, Tim. I just want to come on to your work. Tim's been working on the gut biome, which I think if you've read a newspaper in the last couple of years, you will be somewhat familiar with. But can you talk about what this is and how does your research affect what we should and shouldn't be eating?
So the gut microbiome is basically this huge community of microbes, 100 trillion of them, most of them in the lower part of the intestines, the colon, that really, we've only discovered in the last 5 or 6 years what's become generally well known, and this is an extra organ of our body that weighs the same as our brain. When you stick it all together, there's more cells than cells, there's more microbes than cells in our body, and there's about 300 times more genes. So each of them has a gene that is like a little chemical factory pumping out all kinds of enzymes and chemicals that do all kinds of stuff, making us more hungry, making us more depressed, more sad, breaking down our food in different ways, and affecting our immune system. And so up to now, we've totally ignored this organ, and this is why we've been obsessed with these other insulin-type models of the pancreas and whatever, because our limited knowledge. And now we're understanding this new universe. It's telling us that everybody has a very different microbiome inside them. We only share about 20% of our microbes, whereas we share 99.9% of our genes. And this personalization, this difference between us, is why some people will do better on a low sugar diet and others on a low fat diet, and why we've got so confused over this. And also how knowing how these microbes change our foods, and how we've been slowly killing them off with our bad food. Our processed foods are killing them off, and our antibiotics have been killing them off, and our narrow range of diversity has been killing them off. So people on fad diets are also reducing our microbes we have in us. By studying our 10,000 twins, we've found that the more plant diversity you have, the higher fiber you have, the more different microbes you have, the greater diversity, and that's a huge health benefit, and that goes really throughout everything. If you can get that diversity up, you're going to do well. So we're beginning to understand why we've got everything so wrong, and most of it is down to our gut microbiome, are these microbes that are so different. And we've studied these twins and even found that there are certain microbes that will induce leanness that you never find in overweight people, you only find in skinny people. And you take these bugs like Christensenella, and you take them from the twins and you put them into mouse models, you can stop them getting fat. And these discoveries have been repeated many times. They're very robust, and this is just the tip of the iceberg we're seeing. So suddenly our whole lack of knowledge and poor science before in food is being transformed by this amazing new world, and I think everyone should know about it.
It's so striking to me. I mean, I didn't go to medical school that long ago. I graduated in 2002, and we did not mention the gut biome, except maybe in rare conversation about chemotherapy, radiotherapy, but basically we never talked about
it. Well, they were evil. Microbes were evil, you had to eradicate them, and you know, a good doctor was one that used as many antibiotics as possible and got rid of the whole lot. So it's hard to find anyone in this room who's never taken an antibiotic. You know, it's incredible. And this has been killing off our gut microbes. We're losing our diversity. Compared to our African ancestors, we've lost about 40% of them that will never come back. And these are reducing our ability to fight infections, allergies, and contributing to the obesity epidemic.
So, Gary, can I just pick up on this? Because this does seem to be an enormously important point. When you drill into sugar and hammer away at reducing the sugar in people's diets and aren't too focused on what they might be replacing sugar with, which is what Sarah's emphasizing, Tim's work really seems to undermine that idea. I mean, the importance of a diverse diet. How do you, I know they're not totally mutually exclusive, but you don't emphasize that very much. You've become a bit of a one molecule guy. How do you
one trick pony, I would argue. There's a lot of issues. I don't think, Tim, again, what I want to know is what caused the obesity and diabetes epidemics. The only way to prevent an epidemic is to unambiguously identify the cause. And I do not think that Tim is arguing that some of these epidemics were caused by people eating too much fat and some of them caused by eating too much sugar. I think he would think, as I do, being a scientist, a fan of Occam's razor, that he would assume that whatever caused one epidemic is probably the cause.
Well, hang on, we've got him here. Let's ask him. Tim, what are you saying?
I mean, it's a combination of factors. I think everyone will agree there isn't a single factor that has caused this, you know, doubling or tripling of obesity in the last 30 years.
But Gary wouldn't agree. Gary says it's sugar.
I clearly wouldn't agree.
And Gary thinks that you agree on this, but do you think there's if you've got the overweight people or the obese people of the UK, are a decent portion of them fat because of too much fat and a decent portion of them fat because of too much sugar? Or would you say, it's mostly sugar?
No, I think it's a combination of factors, and we mustn't pick on fat or sugar. It's probably what they're not eating in their diets that would protect them against this. What we used to eat, that old-fashioned, you know, changing our foods, not eating regularly, not worrying about glucose spikes, having long periods without food, all of these things to create a really good microbiome environment that didn't have antibiotics, didn't have processed foods, and then you're able to deal with food in a much more efficient way. So I don't think there's a simple glib answer to say this is the cause of all our problems, but I think you've got to take a more holistic approach and realize that if you cut out one food, you know, you've got to replace it with another, and if we focus on what we should be eating rather than, you know, what having an occasional Coca-Cola is so deadly, then I think we're missing the point.
And how much of it we should be eating, because we haven't even got on to portion size yet.
No.
You know, we are much less physically active than we used to. The average portion size, if you buy an individual chicken pie, it's 70% bigger than it was 15 years ago. So actually, to an extent, because it's happened gradually, I think the public has been fooled. And of course, the more you eat, the more you need to eat.
Or the more bad food you eat.
Yeah.
Can I respond to that?
Can you give us a quick response? Because I want to get to Iran, but yeah.
Yeah, so one of the things, again, because we're coming from different perspectives, one of the things I did in my books, I found obesity and diabetes epidemics. You could find obesity epidemics going back to the Pima Indians in Arizona in the United States in 1902. And these people had gone through 30 years of famines. That's 30 years of eating small portion sizes. You could describe it like that. And yet, when 1902, when a Harvard anthropologist came to live with them, he pointed out that the older members of the tribe had a surprising amount of obesity. And in his seminal text, he actually published a photo of a woman that he named Fat Louisa, who was clearly obese. And also, the women in these Native American tribes tend to do virtually all the manual labor, so physically active as well. You can find populations like, again, even the Pima in the 1950s and 60s, when diabetes erupted in these tribes, the Native and the Inuit tribes, the First Nations populations, that weren't getting antibiotics. So my thinking is we can use these different populations, assuming you believe in Occam's razor, to narrow down the cause. And when you find the one common ingredient in all these populations, they've recently transitioned to diets that are high in sugar and white flour. You can rule out antibiotics, you can rule out portion sizes. Today there's a common phenomenon in exceedingly poor populations called the dual burden of obesity and malnutrition. And these are populations that are so poor, their kids are stunted and malnourished, and yet they too have enormous diabetes rates. Palestinian refugees, for instance, and so, or Western Sahara refugees living in refugee camps in the Algeria, in the Sahara Desert in Algeria. So all I'm saying is, if you look at every population, instead of assuming that our obese population here just eats large portion sizes, you could find populations where large portion sizes are not an option, where antibiotics aren't a problem, and what they always have is sugar and white flour.
Okay, lovely. So thanks, Gary. It's interesting, you mentioned Occam's razor. Occam's razor is wheeled out fairly often. William of Ockham was a 15th century Franciscan monk who lived near Guildford. And so when you say, if we believe in Occam's razor, I'm left going, yeah, well, it may be a bit more complicated than the actual rule is pluralitas non positae sine necessitate, which means you don't need to invoke multiple causes without unless it's necessary. I wonder if in obesity it is necessary, but anyway, we'll come back to it, Gary. Iran, you're running a personalized nutrition project, which is a pretty extraordinary. This feels like the future of medicine and science in many ways. Can you talk to us about how it works, what it does, who comes in, what do you do to them, what do they do to you?
Sure. So it's actually all of these arguments that motivated the project, because we argue a lot, and when I was reading the literature, I felt that actually what we're missing is data, and we're missing hard data. And as a computer scientist, I'm a great believer in data and in unbiased, unprejudiced analysis of data, and that's what this project was all about. So the first thing that we asked ourselves in this project is what should we measure as a marker of healthy nutrition? And usually when I talk about this work, I have to motivate and explain it a lot, but actually this was a great build-up and setup, because as I was reading, and actually Gary Taubes' book on good calories, bad calories was a big inspiration for this, I came to realize that actually these spikes of glucose, which induce secretion of insulin, is really maybe perhaps not the only factor, but definitely a very major factor that could affect our health. It affects our weight gain, because insulin signals cells to store excess sugar as fat. It's definitely related to diabetes, because that's how it's actually defined. But then there's a lot of epidemiological research showing that it's linked to many, many other diseases. And so the one thing that we decided to focus on is post-meal glucose responses. And not less importantly, because it's also very easy to measure it. So what I mean by that is as you know, your blood sugar levels change mainly after you eat, And in healthy people, mainly in the 2 hours after you eat a meal, your blood sugar, your body digests the carbohydrates in the meal and releases them to the bloodstream, where your blood sugar levels go up, and then there's secretion of insulin, whose job is to reduce the blood sugar levels. So,
and you've got some slides of that, right?
Yeah, I'll show you that in a moment. So what we've done is we took 1,000 people. These were random people just coming in, which actually turned out to be fairly representative of the population in Israel in terms of obesity and diabetes and so on. And we've put a continuous glucose monitor on each of them. So that measured glucose levels every 5 minutes for an entire week, 2,000 measurements per person, 2 million glucose measurements in the study. And each had a mobile app. They logged all their meals. So in the end, we had 50,000 meals with full nutritional values. And we could analyze and see what, and that's big data. That's a lot of data. We could analyze what happens. And we found a few pretty striking observations. The first one was that actually when the same person eats the same meal on different days, the response is very similar, very reproducible. But when you give the same food to different people, the response is dramatically different. We had people eating bread, eating ice cream, having essentially no change in glucose levels, and others having huge spikes in glucose levels. And it's not just that people who had spikes for everything. We had people with reverse responses, some eating spiking for rice but not for ice cream, some the other way around. So that was a first striking observation, which basically told us that even before I tell you what our solution was, it tells us that general dietary advice is only going to be very limited in its ability to normalize blood sugar levels in people. So that was very striking observation, I would say. Although in retrospect, when we think about it, this should have been our null hypothesis, also because of what Tim said, because of what was mentioned here, that we're all different. Our genes are different, our microbiome is different. So it would be even a miracle if we all responded the same way. So what we then did is to integrate parameters about different people. The most novel component that we integrated was the microbiome composition of people. And we showed that we could develop an algorithm that basically took many basic parameters, clinical parameters about people, their microbiome composition, and predict with very high accuracy how they would respond individually to meals.
So how each kind of food, not individual ingredient, but each kind of food would affect their blood glucose.
Exactly. So we measured complex meals. Okay. Anything that people eat in real life, that's what we measured, that's what they reported, and that's what we were able to then predict. And the final step of this project was to actually go and intervene and design diets for people, personalized diets for people that would try and normalize their blood sugar levels, and that's what I want to show the slide on very briefly. So what we had was we took a set of people and we asked the algorithm to design for each person two diets, identical in calories. In fact, every meal was identical in calories. But in one case, we asked the algorithm to predict meals that would spike their glucose levels, and in the other, meals that would normalize their glucose levels. And the diets were very surprising. Some people had ingredients that were put on their spiking diet, that were put on the normalizing diets of others. And to just show you that these diets are really not trivial, if we can show the slide, these are actually two diets given to one participant. And you can see what was selected by the algorithm as their good diet and what was selected as their bad diet. Your average nutritionist would probably not prescribe this diet as the good diet, including the ice cream. But we put this pre-diabetic individual on this diet, and we monitored their glucose levels for one full week on the good diet and one on the bad diet. And the next slide that I'll show you was, for us, perhaps the most striking result that came out of the study. And I remind you that every meal that was given to this person was identical in calories. And these were the glucose levels that we saw in this participant, same person, different weeks, same amount of calories in every meal. And what you can see here is that in red is the bad diet. This is the diet that the algorithm predicted would cause spikes, which indeed it does. And it reaches abnormally high glucose levels, indicating that this participant is pre-diabetic. But on the good diet, we achieve full normalization of blood glucose levels. And so I do subscribe to this carb and insulin hypothesis, but I also believe that there is definitely a degree of personalization in knowing which foods personally for you would spike blood sugar levels and which would not. And this is based, I believe, on an unprecedented amount of data of 50,000 meals that we collected, which clearly demonstrates that different people respond very differently to food, the microbiome being a major component driving this.
And in order to, so you do actually have a very significant pathological endpoint here of a blood glucose in a pre-diabetic individual. What you don't have, as far as I'm aware, is that this person isn't losing any any weight over this period of time. And you also don't know about long-term progression in terms of blood sugar and diabetes. Is that right?
Yeah, that's a great point. This study was 4 years of almost more than half of my group to get to this point. These were one-week interventions. What we are doing now is we are doing dietary interventions in both pre-diabetics, type 2 diabetics, and gestational diabetes to follow up long-term and compare these personalized diets to the standard of care. And we're going to look at all of these different endpoints that you mentioned.
And according to you and Gary, you would both expect that these people would lose weight, that they are releasing, they must be releasing, I don't know, are they releasing less insulin? Would you expect them to lose weight? Or are they releasing more insulin and lowering their blood sugar? So
this is actually exactly what we're going to be testing in the research. In the two different groups in each of these studies, we're going to be giving them exactly the same amount of calories, one being the standard of care diet, the other being our personalized diet, that hopefully should be giving them foods that, with the same amount of calories, don't cause as much spikes in blood sugar levels, therefore don't cause as much spikes in insulin, and therefore we believe, based on all the evidence, that would cause, would induce more weight loss, and would also get improvements in fatty liver, in diabetes parameters,
Now, I know you've got some very interesting stuff to say about the biome as well and the mechanisms behind this. I'm conscious of the time and the need for questions. I just want, I know, Sarah, that you wanted to follow this up. The world of personalized medicine is very seductive if you're on Kensington Gore. In Shepherd's Bush, it feels a little different.
On the one hand, can I have your details? Because I'd really like to come and see you. but on the other hand, you said it took you and your group 4 years to get this data on 1,000 people. The simple fact of the matter is, we cannot realistically get this for everybody. And for my patients, their diet is more likely to be determined by what's in the reduced aisle at Lidl than by what they have been told is a really good thing for them to have. You know, we know that, very sadly, processed, refined carbohydrates, sugars, high-fat foods are, on the whole, much, much cheaper than the alternatives. And I can go on till I'm blue in the face about how easy it is for them to go down to Shepherd's Bush Market and get a great big bowl of vegetables, and it only costs a pound, and they've got all that time because they're not working, so actually they could go home and prepare it themselves. And they don't listen, funnily enough. Instead, they go home and they spend all their time on what one of my friends described as the Japanese babysitter, the PlayStation. and, you know, the kids are on there from morning, noon, and night. They're not doing any exercise. They're underestimating the amount that they're eating because they sit and they do something else. They never sit down together as a family and eat. And we know that that means that you're more likely not to graze. We know that grazing is associated with underestimating your calories. We know that people who graze are more likely to be overweight. So, you know, it's fantastic. And yeah, in an ideal world, great. But in the meantime, I think we've got to go with what we've got.
Can I just mention that, I mean, I'm waiting very expectantly to show that there is a long-term weight difference between these groups, because I'm a big fan of Aaron's work, and I think for diabetics, absolutely, you know, this is key. For people who aren't diabetic, I'm not convinced that these glucose spikes are that important, and there's long-term diabetic data showing that drugs that reduce that don't actually change the big outcomes in diabetes. So there's a big question mark that's never spoken about this whole idea, and it just suggests we know very little about, you know, some of the basics we thought we did. And I think by focusing on just glucose, we're missing a bit the point here. And I think, for example, if we take this to logical conclusion, where do you remember that everyone's saying, oh, grazing is better than gorging? That's been a sort of general thing. Never skip breakfast. Okay, the whole basis of that was, oh, that you mustn't have these deadly spikes because, you know, if you haven't had your Kit Kat by 11 o'clock, you're going to fall over and faint. You know, and this was the British mentality, and all based on this glucose spike business. And it turns out this is rubbish. There are now 7 randomized controlled trials showing that people who skip breakfast and have the same amount of calories over the day in less meals will generally either not gain weight or lose weight. So they're all pointing the opposite direction to what the government and all the other gurus have been telling us. So I think we just have to leave a question mark about how much obsessed we get with this glucose insulin thing in normal people, not diabetics, but until the data is better.
Lovely. So at this point, we've got 40 minutes left. And at this point, I think if you're sitting in the audience, you don't know if sugar's good or bad. You're not quite sure about saturated fat. You're definitely not sure if you need a totally personalized diet or whether a bit of common sense should prevail. And you're wondering how to look after the brand new 4-pound massive organ, your gut microbiome, that you previously didn't know anything about. And I can tell you it is not easy trying to sift all this out. In addition to which, we're not sure how much some of this affects our general health and how much of it affects weight loss. And of course, I think, and maybe I'm reading the crowd wrong, I think almost everyone would kill their own grandmother to lose a few pounds, and no one really cares about their long-term health. So we've got this very, very big, rightly or wrongly. So what we're going to do now is throw it open to you all and see what you want to hear about. We have microphones roving around. There is a standing mic at the back. So, oh, there it is. There's a standing mic at the back, which if you've got questions, you can come up. And then we've got, okay, so there are numbers being held up. Does that mean that I go around? I think it means I go around in the order of the numbers. So we're going to take 3 questions at a time, and then I'll sort of sift them out among the panel. So question 1 is over here.
Okay. Did you find any correlation between the blood type and the different ways that people reacted to these diets?
We're going to take them one at a time. Thank you. Question 2.
So my question is probably most to Iran. I mean, I'm a computer scientist myself, and 2 years ago I had some bad news, you can say, that I had diabetes and my A1C was 11.3 and it looked pretty bad, you know, and I was told I couldn't control it with just diet. But the good news was that my body, of course, is a very good measuring apparatus because with such a high level of diabetes, I could immediately measure all the consequences of the food I had. And what I noticed is that I could, without actually having to make a big effort, control it by food, I just had to eat the right food. So my question is that what I did notice was that the advice they gave on many diabetes sites, American sites and other things, that would be absolutely...
What's the question?
My question is, how come that the advice you get from all these diabetes sites, at least in my case, would be completely crazy to eat? My blood sugar would go up to 20 or something. If I, for example, had muesli, oh, you just have 50 grams of muesli and just this and that and the other. And
lovely. So the question is, why is the advice on diabetic information sites
why
so
is it
bad?
So misleading? Because why is it I so find misleading? It extremely misleading, and I could see, and the diet showed up there.
Lovely. It's a lovely question, and we'll farm it out. Thank you. So I should have framed that up. Can we get questions that are quick? Number 3. Thank you.
Yes. All of the speakers, I think, have presented very professionally a certain focus, but they're all concerned, for the most part, with the reaction of the body to consumption, food and drink consumption. There's only Dr. Jarvis who has referred in passing to weight, to exercise. I'd like to hear more about what all of the speakers think about the role of exercise, and also one dimension which hasn't been mentioned at all, which is the effect of mental and emotional stress factors.
Fantastic, that's great. So that's mental, emotional stress and exercise. Thank you. So we've got 3 questions. Eran, can you remember the first question? Because I can't. Lovely, good. can you repeat it for everybody else?
So I'll take the first 2. So the first one was on blood type. So actually, blood type, we did not find any correlations to in responses to food. As to the question of why is advice to diabetics so misleading, I don't know why that is. I think it's because this, again, it goes back to the science that it's based on, is not that good. And I can tell you one specific advice that we had a major work studying artificial sweeteners, which we published several years ago. And what we showed in that work, and I should say, because it relates to your question, artificial sweeteners are recommended officially by the American Diabetes Association as something to eat instead of sugar as a way to control blood sugar levels. And what we showed is actually not only consumption of artificial sweeteners actually not only does not prevent diabetes, but in fact it can induce diabetes. And the way by which we showed that is that consuming artificial sweeteners can alter your gut bacteria such that when we took that altered gut bacteria and transplanted that into mice that are germ-free, that we grow in bubbles without any germs, we transplant those microbiome grown on artificial sweeteners that can induce diabetes in the recipient mice. So definitely I think there's a lot of misleading evidence. I don't know why, but artificial sweeteners is...
I know why.
It would be lovely to get one bit of dogma nailed down this evening. Can I just get artificial sweeteners? Gary, can you just give me a yes or no?
Maybe.
Great. Perfect. Tim, what do you think?
I agree with Aaron. Whether they're as bad as just taking sugar, I'm not sure. But they're certainly much worse than taking water. And they're not an inert free lunch, as they're claimed. So we need to do much more proper work on this.
And Sarah, you're nodding.
Yeah, increasing evidence, I think, not just with type 2, but also with LADA, so which is kind of type 1.5 diabetes, yeah, if you like. However, I would agree that I think they're not as bad as pure sugar.
But a cup of tea would be better than a can of Diet Coke. I hope there's no one from Coke here. Or Diet Pepsi, there we go.
I can just say that...
Green tea.
In our experiments, and we certainly said that more experiments and more long-term and large-scale experiments in human are needed, but in our experiments in mice, adding sugar to the drinking water of mice had no effect on them, but adding artificial sweeteners induced diabetes in the recipient mice. That was our...
Fantastic. And mice aren't people. Mice are not people. Mice in the lab aren't even mice. But still, that
research
is compelling.
We should be careful about artificial sweeteners.
Yeah. Okay. If anyone works for aspartame or anything, we're sorry. Okay. Lovely question up here about exercise and also mental health and kind of psychosocial health. Sarah, can I turf this to you first of all?
One of my favourite studies in all the world is a study called the Diabetes Prevention Programme. Now, Gary is not going to like this study because although it was a randomised controlled trial, it wasn't double-blind. And a double-blind trial is supposed to be the gold standard where studies are concerned. And double-blind means neither the doctor nor the people in the study know which side of the group they're in. And in the Diabetes Prevention Programme, they took a group of people who had pre-diabetes. They divided them into three. One group, they gave, quote, standard advice, which was to slap them on the wrist, tell them they've been bad boys and girls and come back in a year and we check if you've developed diabetes yet. The next group they took and they gave them a tablet, metformin, and the third group they randomized to 4 hours of exercise a week. Now, I defy most people not to know which group they're in. Consequently, of course, it was not a double-blind trial, but the results were extraordinary. When they randomized the group to exercise and to the advice, which was the standard advice at the time, which was a combination of low-fat diet, slightly reduced calories, trying to get them to lose weight by 5%, and also motivational interviewing, which was kind of getting them to choose their own health goals. But I think the exercise played a huge part, and probably soluble fiber in addition. They actually reduced the likelihood of them developing diabetes over the next 4 years by 58%. Mm. And obviously, there are all sorts of lies, damn lies, and statistics, but because the actual risk was so high, that meant that for every four people who increased their level of exercise, they had 2.5 hours of personal trainer a week, they tried to get to 4 hours a week, they could reduce, for every four people who did this, one of them would not have diabetes 4 years later, who otherwise would have done.
I'm a big fan of exercise, absolutely. You know, there's the evidence, exercise is good for you is really incontrovertible, but the evidence that exercise helps you lose weight is really not there long term. Yeah. So I think, you know, there's a mixed message there. I think we should all be exercising, but we shouldn't at the moment be relying on exercise to sort out our obesity epidemic. Yeah. And so this is this false thing, oh, well, if we build a school playground, we'll get rid of the exercise epidemic. There's absolutely no evidence for that. No.
Okay. You can see the frustration of going to your doctor and saying, what should I do? I'm overweight. And they say, exercise. Good. Will that help me lose weight? No, it won't. But you should do it anyway. I love your question because you raise the things that we miss when we talk about the molecular biology and the endocrinology, the sort of hard science. I think mental health and psychosocial aspects of weight loss, and we're talking about multiple endpoints here. We've got diabetes and cardiovascular risk, but weight loss is the kind of linchpin of the conversation because it's so seductive. It's such an important topic personally for so many people. I don't think it's really possible to lose weight without changing your life. It is very, very hard to lose weight without making yourself, in some ways, a more empowered and happier person. And I think a huge number of diet books, and I would exclude the Tim's and Sarah's as well from this, but a huge number of diet books focus on the ingredients you put in your mouth and not why you eat Chinese takeaway every night. And I got to 19 stone because I was miserable. And it was not really focusing. I focused a lot on what I ate, but mainly I just tried to make myself a bit happier and tidy my life up. Tidying your house is probably a better way of losing weight than, according to me, than focusing on how much sugar is in your diet. But sorry, Gary,
can I interrupt
for a second? Anyway, okay, we've got another few questions, right. Who we got? sorry, Gary, we'll come back to it. How are we doing with these questions?
Wait, we're right at a crucial point here.
Okay, Gary, we'll do it on the next round. Question there, number three. Sorry, Gary. We will get to you. Oh. Question number three. Oh. All right. Apparently I'm losing the crowd, so you have your we'll wait for your question.
Okay, a couple of issues. First of all, the problem with trials like the diabetes prevention trial is that it's not just not double blind, it's uncontrolled. So when you ask people to exercise 4 hours a day and change their diet, they will change other things in their diet as well, including what you ask them to put in their mouth. So these people, more than any of the other subjects in the experiment, are less likely to eat sweets and drink soda and drink beer and drink desserts, eat desserts, and they might do it because they think they're cutting calories, or they might do it because they're trying to be healthy, and that's what any of us would do to try to be healthy. But the problem with this kind of trial is that you can't tell at the end whether they lost weight or they prevented diabetes because they exercised or because of all the things they did because they knew they were supposed to work to be healthy every day that the other subjects in the trial might not have done.
Okay, now, I mean, to be fair on Sarah, she did make that point.
Yeah, so, but that's not that it's not double blind, it's uncontrolled. That's a critical point. We have to know why it worked. And my issue with some of this other stuff about exercise, about happiness, and is it implies that people have a profound physiological disorder. You know, 20 to 40 to hundreds of pounds of excess fat got that way because they just couldn't stop eating, you know, Chinese food every night, or because they were unhappy, or because they were stressed. And it makes them feel worse about themselves. When part of the argument with this, rather than call it the insulin carbohydrate hypothesis, call it the hormonal regulatory hypothesis. Those people have a physiological issue that has to be addressed. And maybe if they were happier, they'd be happier about their physiological issue, you know, tens to hundreds of pounds of excess weight. But to imply that they got that way by being unhappy or by being lacking willpower is, to me, the single biggest crime with this energy balance way of thinking.
Do you know, I feel so much better now because I thought I was the only person who didn't know what I was talking about. Apparently you don't either, Zan, so I feel much better now.
Okay, sorry, Sarah, my apologies.
Every day is a school day. Okay, good. Well, thank you for that, Gary. We're going to come back. So there was a lady who had to sit down. Can we get you, and then we'll get two more.
Hi, it's a question for Tim about our gut health. And you were talking about eating a more diverse range of food. But can you say a bit more about that, and how you can improve your gut health? Is it through bone broth? Is it through probiotics? Or is it just diversity? I'd like to say a bit more.
I mean, by his book is the short answer. But okay, so Tim's going to talk about how to improve gut health. Number two.
My question refers to gut biome transplants. And there was something I saw on television recently where a mother and daughter the mother was slim and the daughter was overweight, and the mother had Crohn's, and they gave her a transplant from her daughter's gut biome, and the mother didn't change her diet at all and proceeded to suddenly put weight on, simply because of the differences in the gut biome. Would you potentially advocate for gut biome transplants as a method of weight reduction?
Lovely. And third question up here, number four.
My question also relates to the gut biome, for Tim and Erin as well. Is the personalization of gut microbiome an argument for eating not just seasonally, but locally to our food culture, i.e. should a Greek person stick to Greek food rather than eating Chinese food? And is the globalization of our food a contributing factor to obesity?
Oh, I love that. Worship the local gods. Okay, that's great. That's great. So, God help us if we have to stick to English food. So, lovely. So between Tim and Erin, can you parse those out? So how do we do it? What should we do? And
yeah. So very brief advice about general. So, the general advice is eat lots of fiber. We probably need to eat double the amount of fiber. We've lost that. We used to just think fiber was just to stop constipation. And no one is promoting fiber because there's no real money in it. And that's a big problem in the last 20 or 30 years. So I think we'd all agree more fiber.
But just say what is, say more fiber, but what is that? Is that a bag of kale a day? What does it look like? What is on your plate?
What is on my plate? I have lots of vegetables with my meals. It's taking meat off the plate allows you to put more vegetables on the plate. That's okay. One thing I've learned. You can't get all your fiber from fruit because that's really bad for you, and you don't get as much fiber from the fruit.
But because there's too much sugar in fruit, is that if you ate enough fruit to get the fiber?
If you just ate bananas, you would get too much sugar, and it's not a balanced way to eat it. And I think, we've explained that we don't want to do too much of everything. So the best way to get fiber is through a range of vegetables that you vary every day, and it's not the same vegetables. Not just eating potatoes, it's eating potatoes and sweet potatoes and lentils and mixing it all up. And there's much diversity because the more fiber you have that's diverse, the more different species you're actually helping in your gut. And I think we've got to go back to this Mediterranean style eating that, Iran knows all about, that is, that's combined with these products. So lots of fiber, diversity. Fermented foods we've forgotten about. Most of us eat yogurt, but we have the nasty artificial sweetener, low-fat yogurt from the supermarket, not the natural stuff with live microbes in it.
Make your own?
You can make your own, or go the next step is to go to kefir, which is fermented milks, which has probably up to 10, 20 types of different microbes in there rather than just the two or three varieties you get in yogurt.
Kimchi, sauerkraut.
All of those things, because they're mixing probiotic live microbes with the fertilizers. And so think of it as fertilizing your garden, and you can't go wrong. So I think it's this diversity, it's avoiding processed foods, it's more fiber, and it's...
Lovely. And the rest is in the book.
The rest is in the book.
You've got to spend some money. You can eat each page as you read it, and that will be polyphenols. There you go.
They're food for your microbes as well. So that's... And the last one was...
Fecal transplants.
Fecal transplants.
Does it work? Is it true? Is it just daily mail headlines?
Are there dangers of it? I think that was the question, wasn't it? So, yes, the two ways to transform your gut microbiome. The first one is bariatric surgery, which is the only cure for diabetes, and that totally transforms your microbes within 48 hours, and is probably the reason that you're cured. The second one is a fecal transplant, which is now used routinely for people with certain infections, Clostridium difficile infections. Now, you want to pick the donor properly. So you want a nice, skinny, healthy, good-looking donor that you want the best microbes from. And if you pick someone who happened to be a bit overweight or a psychotic killer, there's a chance that those microbes could wear onto you. So as long as you do it safely, and that most of these screening programs are very safe now, you should be fine.
I don't know why you're not selling this stuff on the internet. Anyway, that's a thought for you.
They are being sold. They're called crapsules.
Iran. Yeah.
So also just a word of caution. I think there's been, microbiome has been in the news, and we see it now every day, and it's very hyped. I think there's a lot of evidence to suggest that the microbiome is definitely playing a major also causal role in many, definitely in metabolic disease, but others. But I will also say that the microbiome field is very young. It's less than 10 years old, and we're still learning a lot. So for example, fecal microbiome transplantations, we're learning that they don't always work. Sometimes they have these side effects. They work in some people, from some donors and some recipients. It's still early days. And also the notion of kind of good bacteria and bad bacteria is definitely oversimplified. Some bacteria can be good in some contexts, but can be bad in other contexts. So we're still really learning this, although we are definitely demonstrating that the microbiome is very causal. So we had work, for example, just now, showing that this effect of yo-yo dieting, where you gain weight, you go on a diet, but you then regain the weight back, and actually with every bout of diet, you actually gain more and more weight. We recently demonstrated that actually is caused by your microbiome. Your microbiome changes when you gain weight, and when you lose the weight, it doesn't quite go back to what it was. And that is sufficient to actually, when you're put on the same diet as your friend who didn't have this cycle of gaining weight, on the exact same diet, you will gain more weight. So somehow the microbiome is playing a role, and we showed in that case that it affects the energy expenditure. So if you had this history of being overweight, your microbiome will produce secrete molecules that will cause you to expend less energy, and that is a mechanism which we showed is a way by which you will actually gain more weight. So it's definitely causal, but I think we still don't know exactly, despite some general advice, which is probably good and true. In more detail, it's still early days, and we're still learning what is good and what is bad, and most likely, I believe, the answer is going to be personalized and depend on the exact microbiome of the person.
Yeah, making a very good point, and also why we shouldn't be doing these calorie, restricted diets that actually end up with the opposite effect happening, because you showed very nicely in these animals exactly what happens in humans, and we've been studying these twins for 20 years. Those that go on diets end up always fatter than their identical twin who don't.
Right. Hello. I'm living proof. I'm still like, oh, I got within a kilo of him earlier this year. Oh, well, I'll get there. I love this last question, actually. My feeling, and I will ask the others, but my feeling is the Greeks know how to eat Greek food, and the Italians know how to eat Italian food. If you go to Italy, they don't serve you garlic bread with the lasagna. We invented that in England. And so we put mayonnaise on the side as well. So I actually think eating, it's not just the Greek-style food. If you go and eat food in that place with those people, with those specific ingredients in the way they eat it, if they're a thin group of people, the Japanese, the Greeks, the Italians, it's probably something more than just the ingredients. But I don't know if that's what do you make of it, Sarah?
I would tend to agree. I was working not that long ago in Saudi Arabia, where they have a 22% incidence of type 2 diabetes, and now 98% of people with diabetes have got type 2, which kind of dwarfs the UK population if we think we're bad. But interestingly, they haven't changed what they eat that much. They are still eating a fairly similar Saudi Arabian diet. They are eating more sugar than they were, but they're just eating so much more of it and exercising so much less. And of course, they, whether you believe in the theory of the thrifty gene or not, they, we know that people who have, in terms of evolution, come through great periods of famine, tend, on the whole, as we've seen with the Indians, to be more prone to putting on weight, and particularly intra-abdominal fat, which is, of course, metabolically active and what's so damaging for all of us. If you then take people like that, who are very efficient at storing and using energy and not expending too much of it, and you give them vast quantities of locally sourced food, they will still become vastly overweight.
Right. Plenty of fat people in Greece as well. Lovely. So we've got more questions. So we've got one on the corner here. Here we are. I'm not running this very well. Here we go. Let's start with you.
So I'm wondering. I read your book and I was fascinated by the fact that you actually criticize your own work. And I'm wondering, how are you scientists going to find some common way of doing research so that it actually makes sense and that we can read something in the papers and actually trust it?
Okay.
Who can we trust? Lovely. So up there, number four.
Hi, Professor Siegel. You mentioned endurance athletes and sport. I'm curious to know a little bit more about what these people are doing with their diet on a day-to-day basis to kind of optimize performance, maintain weight, lose weight, whatever it is they're trying to achieve from an endurance sport aspect.
What should the endurance athletes be doing? Lovely.
What are they doing?
At the back there.
Coming back to that point earlier about stress, did you, Erin, in the research you did, look at groups who were in a parasympathetic state compared to a sympathetic state when they were eating their food, then look at the blood glucose after? Did those two states have any effect on glucose levels?
The two states, sorry?
A parasympathetic tone and sympathetic tone.
Mm-hmm. Great. So a question about the background levels of stress in your nervous system. So we'll get an Erin. Yeah. Erin will expand on that. Lovely. Tim, can we start with that? Who can we trust? Can we trust
so
you?
Yeah, I do a mea culpa and say a lot of the studies I've done in my career have been wrong. And one of the first ones, I found this association between coffee drinking and cancer of the pancreas, and that started my academic career. And it was a great paper, but it's all complete rubbish. Yeah. But I think real scientists admit their mistakes, and other people and are happy to have, they're not obsessed with one hypothesis. And the problem with this field of nutrition is that people have been obsessed with a single hypothesis and not had the scientific rigor that happens in other areas of science to actually contradict it and move on. And this is really true of this area. You know, Erin and I were both in genetics, still are, and this is an area where, you know, when something's found to be wrong, you move on and you don't keep this dogma, and you don't have government websites frightened to stop telling people to never skip breakfast when it's untrue. And yet we've got this mentality that we never admit we were wrong and that, you know, we need to start again. So I don't think all is lost. We just need to get nutrition up to the level of some other sciences, like genetics or physics or whatever it is, where you can discuss these things openly, it's debated, and you look at the evidence and you move on without this entrenched view that, as Gary has said, is often influenced by industry and other forces that really shouldn't be there telling us what to think.
Gary, can you just give us a word on that? Because I think your writing has enormously shaped my skepticism about the diet literature, particularly the influence of the Corn Growers Association, the dairy councils, these kind of things. Can you just briefly, how do you decide who to trust as a journalist?
Well, I make those decisions based on what I think are who's doing good science. And occasionally the industry is actually pushing good science. So the industry is out there defending their products. If their products get attacked, they will respond. If their products get attacked by minority viewpoints, they'll respond. They'll pay other researchers to express the majority. But that's, so even though I've described the industry influences, I think the initial problem is actually the science itself. A lot of what Tim said, I think, you know, getting to the question of who do we trust and how do we solve this dilemma where everyone's got a different perspective or people we respect have different perspectives. I think it starts with the at the very top, because, again, we have these terrible epidemics of obesity and diabetes. I know in the United States, I don't know what the number is for the UK, but in the US are estimated to cost direct medical costs of the healthcare system of $1 billion a day. And we kind of treat it as business as usual. we blame the people for being obese or diabetic. We blame the food environment. We blame the food industry. But what we don't have is something our government saying, look, this is a crisis. We have to treat it like a crisis. You know, if 1 in 11 people in the UK had Zika or Ebola, you wouldn't be able to cross the street without a researcher trying to figure out what we didn't understand about this disease. But with obesity and diabetes, we blame the industry, we blame the fat people, we blame the economy, and we assume we know the truth. And what we need is the same kind of effort going after those two diseases, questioning our assumptions, all of our assumptions, rigorously testing them, coming to some, you know, unambiguous conclusions, so people don't have to sit and hear a panel disagree on what the causes are.
Okay, lovely. All right. Sorry for the disagreement. So, A question up there about endurance athletes, yeah. Iran.
So stress and endurance athletes. So with regards to stress, so we did subjectively measure stress as reported by participants in our study. Stress does, and this is known, and we also saw this in our data, stress does induce higher glucose levels. Whether that has longer term impact, that needs to be studied. With respect to endurance athletes, so there's so much to study. We did not have a focus group of that, but I will say that I believe that whatever is true in terms of these glucose spikes and so on for the general population would be true for that for them. I can give you anecdotally an N equals one story, just from personal experience. I found out when profiling myself as part of these studies that I'm quite sensitive to carbohydrates, in particular to dates and rice and bread. So I started taking these out of the diet, eating less and less of them. And I found out that previously I used to eat, say, a bowl of pasta and take some readily carbs before runs, like dates and so on. Yet, and I would finish the runs, and then half an hour later, like a 20-mile run, I would finish. I would be very, very hungry afterwards. When I switched to this other type of diet, now I could eat a salad the night before, go on a 20-mile run without eating anything in the morning, and not even be hungry for hours later. So I don't think that will be true for everybody, because I believe with all the data that we collected, we really do see personalized responses to different meals.
But there's possibly a benefit. But I think more than just...
Yeah, and when you feel it on yourself, then you become a believer.
Sure.
And it's and I think the key point, and this also relates to the first question, that it's really a lot about data. So if you see the data and you see the evidence for it, then that makes you a believer, because that's hard evidence.
Question at the back, Iran, it was to you. Can you just explain it a little bit more, what the parasympathetic-sympathetic balance was, the autonomic question?
Well, so the question is whether that also induces hormonal responses that would also cause you to have altered hormonal balance, and then by that also induce these spikes. And like I said, we've measured stress as reported by individuals, and we saw some relationships. Yeah.
We got time for another three. I think the final three questions. Final three quick questions. Great. Lovely. We got one here.
We have been speaking about sugar, but I'm particularly interested in one half of what sucrose is, which is fructose, which doesn't actually induce any insulin spikes and so on, but seems to have very detrimental effects, one of which is that it totally bypasses the feeling of fullness and satiety. So if someone were to have a high fructose diet, they might eat higher portion sizes than the next person. And yeah, if you could just speak a bit more about fructose.
Talk about fructose, that's lovely.
The food companies, are they responsible to the point where we've reached a point with the tobacco companies that there was the statistics that people were dying because of smoking. So the tobacco companies were taxed for that reason and patients took stock. How close are we, or are we never going to reach that point, because the food industries have got so much power? When are we actually really going to take that seriously, that there are the stats that certain foods and lifestyles and diets are killing people?
Lovely, lovely question. And the final question up at the back there.
Do fatty diet books, often not written by health professionals or anyone that's ever spoken to a patient, help or not help us deliver good public health messages?
Can you just repeat the first bit again? I just missed it.
Do fatty diet books, often written by non-health professionals, help or not help us deliver public health messages?
Diet books not written by me or other members of the panel are utterly unhelpful.
Maybe not written by people who understand the effect that bad science can sometimes have on their patients.
It is
in terms of being confused, because I think I'm speaking as a dietitian of many, many years, and I think many of the hypotheses in the last 30 or 40 years have made our patients not trust us. And I'm not sure that just avoiding fat or sugar or salt or anything has helped in the last 40 years, because we're fatter than ever, with more diabetes than ever, and less trust in health professionals, and we've just badmouthed every message.
It's a lovely question, and so we'll finish on that. Thank you. The first question was about fructose. Gary, I think you're the fructose man. Can you give us a brief, how much should we worry about fructose as a specific kind of sugar?
Well, fructose is half of beet sugar and cane sugar. It's 55% of the common form of high fructose corn syrup. I just wrote a book about called The Case Against Sugar. So obviously that on some level is the case against fructose. The fructose is metabolized in the liver, so it's not spiking blood sugar. Although when we consume sugar, we get the blood sugar spike in association with the metabolism of fructose in the liver. And what I'm arguing, and it may or may not be right, is that fructose, this metabolism of fructose in the liver in association with blood sugar and insulin might be the fundamental cause of insulin resistance, that it's likely to be, and that this is the reason, again, this is why we should avoid sugar. I do want to address the food industry question, since I've written a lot about that. And I think we do the food industry a disservice, because at least in the United States, they change the products they produce in order to give the American public what the public health authorities were telling them. So all these low-fat yogurts that are full of sugar or high fructose corn syrup were created, at least in the U.S., at the behest of the Centers for Disease Control. So I think the food industry will give us what we ask for. And the question is, because our public health advice is so confused, the third question, if we give the wrong advice, if we base our advice on incorrect hypotheses, then that's what the food industry is going to give us, and we end up fatter, more diabetic, unhealthier. So it all starts with getting the science right.
Thanks very much, Gary. Sarah, can I ask you about those issues then, particularly the food industry and the diet books?
I'm, strangely enough, slightly with Gary here. Dangerous territory though that may be, because I feel that actually there are many people within the diet, within the food industry, who have tried. And interesting, I have a friend who is an industry, food industry dietitian, and she's been kind of tearing her hair out because her company, which produces baby products, and you know, mothers want food that their child can have on the go, has developed this, had spent, invested huge amounts of money in pure vegetable baby products, which didn't have any additives, didn't have anything else. And they ended up having to pull them because people wouldn't buy them. So I think to an extent, these are commercial companies, and they have sometimes worked very well, I think, with industry. If we think that, for instance, cornflakes contain 15% less salt than they did, and we're moving, and that requires them all to work together. There is an element of self-interest. They are commercial organizations. To an extent, I absolutely agree with you that, you know, they need to be called to account, but by the same token, they probably need to be called to account by the great British public. And when the great British public responds to Jamie Oliver's pleas by shoving fish and chips through the railings of schools, then I think, you know, we have our answer.
And food companies also, I mean, they did low-fat yogurt, not because of great altruism, but actually it was cheaper than having the full dairy brand, because adding in other chemicals. So yes, Gary's right that they were reacting to the market, but they loved it because this is another way they can make much more money and leverage, you know, get greater profits from this stuff. So if you remove that incentive, then they would stop it. So I think we've got to look at it. It's much more complex than just they're evil and, you know, or they're just doing what the bidding is. But the more complicated, the more artificial the food, the more the margins these companies can make. And that's why we need to go back to trying to educate everyone to get back to real food and try and get the incentives there for the public.
So we've had, that's a fantastic answer, thank you. And we've presented you with a very, very wide range of topics, just from healthy eating to particular aspects of weight loss. Clearly we don't all agree, and yet there are areas of common ground. I'm curious to know who, as a result of this evening, has made a serious commitment to changing the way they will eat in some way? Can I get a show of hands? It's really interesting. So it's that confusing. It's probably half the people in the room have managed to do it. It's extremely confusing data set. Tim and I will be signing books outside or just saying hello if you don't want to buy a book. Can I just say thank you very much to Gary in the US and to all our panelists, and thank you to you all.
Thank you.